How's it going? Today, I'm going to talk with you about existentialism and Jean-Paul Sartre. So this is good. I like this article. I like existentialism, and I'm excited to talk with you about it, or talk to you about it, and then you'll talk back to me when you do your writing for this week. Jean-Paul Sartre, who is the author of this little short article that we read, Jean-Paul Sartre is an existentialist. Existentialism is a philosophy which is grounded in the notion of radical freedom and of radical personal responsibility. For the most part, existentialists are atheists, meaning they do not believe in God, or at least agnostic. In other words, hold the position that there might be a God, but there's no way we're going to know in any sort of epistemologically certain way. And so, therefore, we might as well carry on as if there isn't a God because we can't know. So, let's take matters into our own hands here and, fix this world. So, you can still believe in God and be an existentialist, but you might begin to see as we talk more about that, that there are some ways in which, depending on how you cash out your notion of God, there are some ways in which a higher power, the existence of a higher power, and the tenets of existentialism are going to butt heads a bit. But you can make sense of it, so you'll just see how it goes. So some of the stuff that I say in this video might, I hope it's not offensive to someone who believes in God, but just know that I'm trying to portray existentialism, which is largely an atheistic or agnostic philosophy. So, existentialism is filled with several sort of fundamental concepts. So, what I hope this video will accomplish will clarify these concepts for you. So, the first sort of fundamental existential concept is this notion of individualism. In existentialism, people are radically free, subjective individuals, meaning we make our own decisions, we are our own people, and we create value in this world through our choices. So we'll start with this idea of individualism. Connected to that is this essence and existence thing. So there's two real different ways of thinking about us as individuals. One is through this idea where essence precedes existence, and the other idea is that existence precedes essence. So with essence preceding existence, the idea here is that if my essence precedes my existence, that means that what I am precedes that I am. If my essence precedes my existence, my essence is my what, my how, my who, my nature. So some people, often people who believe in a higher power, often these people believe that their essence, who they are, precedes that they are. So if people say, "Oh, I was meant to be a teacher, I was meant to be a attorney, I was meant to be a doctor, I was meant to be a musician, I was meant to be in anything," that would suggest that your essence, who you are, preceded that you are, that you were meant to be, that you were destined to be, that you had some essence in you that was just waiting to emerge. Jean-Paul Sartre rejects this notion completely. Sartre believes that your existence, that you are, preceded your essence. We create our essence, Sartre believes, through our choices. There is no I was meant to be anything. Sartre rejects the notion of human nature. He does not think that I am any way except for how I choose myself to be. I am what I choose. I exist in this world. That is for sure. Anything else is based on what I have chosen. I am nice, I am not nice, I am kind, I am unkind, I am successful, I am unsuccessful, simply because the choices I made made me that person. I made myself that person through my choices. So for Sartre, my existence, that I am, preceded my essence, who I am. Who I am is who I have chosen to be. There was no plan prior to my existence. So this is a very important concept for Sartre as well. Because my existence precedes my essence, because that I am preceded who I am responsible for who I am. If my essence preceded my existence, then I'm not responsible. If I was meant to be a teacher, then in a sense, I'm not really responsible for here I am teaching at the College of Lake County. But for Sartre, because I was nothing prior to my choices, I am fundamentally responsible for anything that I am because I have chosen everything that I am. To Sartre, this is powerful. This is what we want. Sort of. We want it. We should want it. But in reality, we don't want responsibility. I don't want responsibility. I want to blame stuff on other things. I want to blame it on God. I want to blame it on my kids. I want to blame it on, you know, being PMS. I want to blame it on being tired. I want to blame it on having a weakness for chocolate. I want to blame it on anything I can blame it on. I don't want the responsibility. Sartre calls this bad faith. Because of the anguish that I experience through personal responsibility, I make up stories to trick myself, to make myself believe that I'm not really responsible, because responsibility is terrifying. So Sartre thinks we are radically free. We do not want this freedom. This freedom is terrifying. It causes us anguish. We therefore make up stories to trick ourselves into making it seem like we're not really responsible. This is called bad faith. We believe that I don't know if we really believe it, but we experience anguish, right? We experience suffering, pain, trying to make a decision about where to go to school or what to have our work be or what to do with our children or how to react to other people's behavior. Or responsibility sucks, right? If I can say that, responsibility sucks. It is overwhelming. It is terrifying. You know, speaking for myself, worrying about my kids, worrying about my work, worrying about my family, feeling guilty about my dog, walking her or not walking her. I don't want this responsibility. And if I can make up stories that make it seem to myself like I'm not really responsible, like it was God or the weather or the this, oh, then I can feel much better. I had a student once, this was a long time ago, who told this story to me. She was driving home from work. She lived out on the East Coast somewhere at this time. She was driving on the work home from, she reports that she saw a person standing on the side of the bridge contemplating taking his or her own life, right? To jump off the bridge, to commit suicide. And she tells me, this student of mine, that she stopped and she thought about what she should do. Should she get out of the car and talk to this young person and say, what are you doing? Or don't jump off the bridge or whatever. But this student of mine reports that at that time, the time when she was about to get out of her car, God spoke to her and God said, you don't need to go talk to that person, that it's not your responsibility, that you should go home and be with your family, and that if this person was meant to take their life, they will, and that it's not, God told this student of mine, according to the student, that it's not her responsibility to stop them, and went home. Well, I don't know, but I know the story is different if it instead goes that my student thought about getting out of the car and talking to this person, but instead my student said, I am going to make a choice not to do that, or make a choice to do that. In other words, when we take responsibility for our choices, for our behavior, whether our choices are right or wrong, whether they had good consequences or bad consequences, it is a radically different relationship that I have to that experience if I take responsibility for the choice or if I pawn off the responsibility on someone or something else. I have a radically different relationship to that decision if I am responsible versus God or my hunger or my tiredness or my PMS, and existentialism wants me to be responsible, wants you to be responsible. We don't want to be responsible. It's way too scary. We make up stories. That's called bad faith. The responsibility causes us anguish. And that's existentialism. Just consulting my notes, what else I should tell you. So this notion of authenticity is tremendously important to existentialism. To be authentic, to be real, to take responsibility. This is at the heart of existentialism. Let's just look briefly at the reading and some of the quotes that maybe you could use some help in deciphering. So the first sentence says, man is nothing else but what he makes of himself. So sorry for the sexist language here, but a person is nothing else but what one makes of oneself. Meaning, I have no destiny, I have no predetermined anything, I am nothing else but what I make of myself through my choices. Man first exists. Man, first of all, is the being who hurls himself towards a future and who is conscious of imagining himself as a being in the future. So we are creating ourselves in the future. I like this. Part of a plan which is aware of itself rather than a patch of moss, a piece of garbage, or a cauliflower. Nothing exists prior to this plan. There is nothing in heaven. Man will be what he will have planned to be. I will be what I choose for myself. And that this is the first paragraph here. And then he talks about existence preceding essence. There's also this idea that in choosing for myself, I choose for everyone. At the bottom of the second, paragraph, it says, to choose to be this or that is to affirm at the same time the value of what we choose, because we can never choose evil. So Sartre believes when we choose, we would only choose good. We wouldn't choose anything that we think is bad for ourselves. So when we choose, we ascribe value to that. When I do something, I am calling that something good. This is sort of like, if I drink in front of my kids, if I smoke in front of my kids, if I swear in front of my kids, I'm calling that good in a way. Through my choice, I am giving value. Sartre, existentialists, do not believe things have intrinsic value. Intrinsic value is saying that something has value in and of itself. Existentialists do not believe that. Existentialists believe we give value, we make value, we create value through our choices. This is the bottom of the third paragraph. I am responsible for myself and for everyone else. I am creating an image of man of my own choosing. In choosing myself, I choose man. In other words, I create humanity through my choices. But we don't like this. This is where he talks about anguish and forlornness and despair. This is bad, 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 this responsibility of choosing. I try and get out of this anguish through this notion of bad faith, through making up stories about God or whatever. At the end of the day, however, my life, and really, the life of all of humanity is in my hands. It's really very powerful, right? If I give up responsibility, this is existentialism talking, so you can disagree if you want to, but just at least understand it. To an existentialist, if I relinquish my freedom, if I give responsibility to God or to a higher power, who am I? What am I? If I give up the responsibility, am I going to give up my power? The idea is that in some religious liturgy, right, there's we should pray for this, we should, you know, if God wants this, God will do this. It's like, if I want it, I will do it. If I want to end hunger, I need to act to end hunger. If I want justice, I need to act to create justice. I cannot simply pray. I can't wait for God to do it. I must act, and I must view myself and my fellow human beings as responsible for the world. There is pain and suffering. It is not because God wants pain and suffering. It is because fellow human beings, myself included, have made choices that have created this pain and suffering. We as human beings have the fundamental responsibility to change this world. We are responsible for what the world is, and we must act through our choices. We cannot wait. We cannot merely pray. We must take responsibility. It is a tremendously empowering position. And it makes me very excited to talk about it. We'll go on a little bit more. So I'm now at the bottom of the page here, of the third page. We are alone with no excuses. I love that, right? We can be anything. We can do anything. we are alone with no excuses. It is, right? It's a silly little motto, right? But if it's going to be, it's up to me, right? I don't need to look to anyone or anything else. I am alone with no excuses. I want to do it, baby. Well, then do it. I run into obstacles, figure them out. It is empowering. He then says, man is condemned to be free, right? This is a condemnation of sorts. To be alone with no excuses is a condemnation. That is freaking terrifying. It is terrifying to be alone with no excuses. That is terrifying. I do not want that. I want excuses. I don't want to be alone. I want to believe in God. I want to believe in life after death. I want to believe in heaven. There's a better place. There's something else. Guess what, baby? This is it. I am alone with no excuses. Okay, what am I going to do now? I am going to grab life by the collar and I am going to take responsibility. I am going to make of my life what I want to make. Okay. Woohoo. Existentialism. So I hope that that helped a little bit with the reading. Sorry if I got excited. This is exciting to me. We'll talk about Camus next, which I also might get excited about because I just love the... I love where it puts us as a human, right? It's terrifying at the same time, but it's invigorating. So I'm curious to know what you think. So I'll talk to you soon.